I thank all my teachers. Sushma ma'am, I met almost about 15 years ago in one of the conferences madam had organized in Ames. It's been a constant updation from there, and I'll continue to update. A special mention of my mentor, Dr. Naveen Silence. He's more than an elder brother to me. I think the credit goes to my teachers, like you, ma'am, and sir, who have actually made what I am today. Without much wasting time, I will start my slides. I hope you can all see.
Yeah, we can see, Dr. Ravi.
Yeah, thank you. So, approach to a patient with dyselectrolemias, electrolytelemias, part 2 in palliative care. Now, I would hypocalcemia, hypermagnesemia, as well as hyperphosphatemia is what it is. The flow going to be on my outline. Here is a case, a 34-year-old male, carcinoma oropharynx. It was referred to us on a Sunday morning when he had actually undergone surgery, chemotherapy, radiation. He had completed all of it. And it was progressive for some time, which they had mentioned. And the patient had actually absconded from follow-up because he had gone for alternative therapies. Now, this patient came back to the hospital in an emergency, and what was the main problems was he had developed weakness in the lower limbs. His pain was severe, so he was screaming in pain, especially in the legs, vomiting, 15 episodes is what the wife reports. He was constipated since the last 6 days is what she also adds. The biggest worry she had as a wife was he was addressing her as her elder sister. The trauma which she had in terms of actually him addressing her as her elder sister was something which she would never ever get over is what she told. Oral cavity pain and discharge was there, purulent discharge. He had fever for 3 days and sleep was completely disturbed. That is, he will sleep in the mornings or evenings or whatever it could go to. Examination, candidiasis and purulent discharge was there. He was severely dehydrated. Neurological deficits were there, right lower limb more than left. When we examined the abdomen, bladder was distended and rectum was actually full. Now, basic investigation, CBC led to high counts, which were around 25,000 plus of the WBC. And serum electrolytes, when we got calcium, was 18.2 milligrams on the real values and corrected, because I'll talk about how to correct, it was around 19.4. So serum creatinine was 2.9 milligrams percent. This was the MRI, which showed a huge metastasis in the spinal, and there was compression of the cord going on chordae equina. Now, all electrolyte imbalances are acute palliative care aspects of management. APCU model is where we will have to actually put across. Now, supportive care, the complications which we manage were cord compression, sepsis, hypercalcemia. So what I wanted to bring about in this case is hypercalcemia does not come as a single entity. It comes as a mixture of issues and problems. So we will have to look into it, understand what it is, and then go about putting across what has to be done for this patient. Or the main symptoms could be checked, but we cannot forget all the other problems or other aspects. It has to come in conglomeration rather than as a single entity, which will not be presenting to us. Within 72 hours, pain had reduced, nausea was better, fever was controlled, constipation was relieved, halitosis was reduced, sleep was better, delirium actually took some more time for about 4 or 5 days, but weakness has improved. As I mentioned, we had started steroids, radiation, other things, all those aspects should be going on in side by side. So welcome all for the follow-up of the second part of the dyselectrolemias in palliation. Now coming to calcium. Now, calcium is an ion in a cation is in a 70 kg person. It's around 1.86% of the body weight. It's the most abundant cation in a human body. There are two different types of calcium. That is the mineral form, which forms the 99% of the body content, in the hydroxyapatite form, that is mineralized in the bones. Whereas there are three salt forms, free or ionized calcium, which is around 50%, which is the active component of all processes which is required for the physiological things like enzyme activation, blood coagulation, cell growth, metabolism, muscle and nerve functioning properly. Now others could be, the 40% is plasma protein bound. So therefore, when you have a plasma protein bound specific to albumin, yes, there is a little bit to globulins, but majority is albumin. So therefore, most of our palliative care patients have hypoalbuminemia as the disease trajectory goes on because of pure the decreased nutritional levels and other aspects which could be responsible for it. So therefore, albumin is something which is very, very important, not only for calcium, for magnesium, as well as the phosphate also, it becomes important over here. So for us, whatever we're talking about calcium can be reflected in the other two electrolytes. That's why it is bundled up as a single entity for our discussion today. Now, coming to calcium, how is the homeostasis occurs? If you have decreased calcium, the first step, the parathyroid hormone secretion actually increases. Once it increases the parathyroid hormone, it acts on, stimulates the osteoclasts. So therefore, osteoclasts actually promote calcium being taken up, and then it brings into the blood vessel. So therefore, osteoclastic activity is increased. So therefore, it comes. The next step would be the kidney, wherein actually it tells the kidney to actually produce vitamin D3 more. That is the cholecalciferol 1,25 dihydroxycholecalciferol increased production or the conversion from the single hydroxylation to the bihydroxylation. What vitamin D does is in the small intestine, it tells the small intestines to pick up calcium, or absorption of calcium is increased. So therefore, again, going into the blood. Now, if you have more in the blood, now again, it is a negative feedback. And if you, the sensing leads to increased calcitonin production in the thyroid gland itself, which actually inhibits the osteoclasts, which allows for enhanced osteoblastic activity, that is deposition of mineralization. So it is a homeostasis, which is important over here. Now, coming to hypercalcemia, what is the normal range of calcium? Somewhere around 8.5 to around 10.5 is what the calcium normal levels or the levels in the body or the blood could be. Now, usually adults have somewhere around 9 to 10. Now, mild hypercalcemia is just beyond 10.5. Moderate is around 12 plus to 14, and severe or hypercalcemic crisis is what we call is actually 14 plus. And this is where an ionized serum calcium also could be important. So if you have an understanding that you could get all these values, then it's fine. Otherwise, at least the corrected calcium and other things could lead to some form of betterment. Now, it is important that you bundle up whenever you're investigating a patient or high degree of suspicion is there when the symptoms of hypercalcemia occur. Mainly, hypercalcemia can be diagnosed whether depending upon the parathyroid hormone. Calcium as well as phosphate are very closely linked to the parathyroid hormone and the magnesium to a large extent on these two electrolytes. So it depends saying that whether it is primary hyperparathyroidism, wherein the levels are very, very high, or it could be parathyroid independent, specific to our group of patients, wherein there is malignancy. And I'll come to what is the reason for malignancy leading to so much of hypercalcemia, wherein it is parathyroid hormone independent. Now, it could go into the lower levels also, wherein secondary hyperparathyroidism is there because of deficiencies or chronic renal failure, where we could have patients which are not oncological, non-oncological to a large extent of CKDs, chronic kidney disease could be there, wherein you have multiple electrolytes like phosphate and others also will be possible to have issues. Now, surgical resection could also be one of the causes. Now, in hypercalcemia, coming back, parathyroid dependent and parathyroid independent. Most of the malignancies are here, 10 to 30% of all malignancies specific to solid organ, mainly say a breast, which can actually have metastasis and osteoclastic activity can increase that, or to a large extent myeloma, wherein you have creatinine issues as well as the calcium. Almost 50% of myeloma patients in hematological cancers could have this. Now, parathyroid hormone related protein, wherein it is de novo increases the levels of the parathyroid-like hormone. It is actually secreted in squamous cell carcinoma of the lung and RCC renal cell carcinoma and head and neck cancers. It is very, very important that we have head and neck cancers. I presented a case of head and neck cancer itself. Or an ectopic 1-alpha hydroxylase, which is actually seen in lymphoma, wherein it actually converts the 1 into 125 dihydroxycholecalciferol, that's the active D3, which actually increases the intake or the absorption. Now, elevated vitamin could be there, or normal vitamin D3. So these are all the causes. Primary could be adenoma, carcinomas, and men 1 and 2. Now, coming per se to oncology perspective itself, humoral hypercalcemia of malignancy 80%. Now, where what happens is, as I was mentioning just now, the parathyroid hormone related protein is what it is going to be. It is just going to act like parathyroid hormone, and it is going to increase, as I had mentioned, in the homeostasis milieu of the first to the fourth step, which we had seen. What are the clinical features of hypercalcemia? It actually has got a host of issues on all these systematic things. You would see the same amount of changes in the next two electrolytes, that is hypomagnesemia and hyperphosphatemia, almost similar clinical features. So therefore, when you have this clinical feature, you should have a high suspicion that it could be in terms of actually having a problem, which is any of these electrolytes could be in combinations. Neurologically, it could be irritability, depression, lethargy, sedation, delirium, leading later on to stupor and coma, anorexia, nausea, vomiting, and constipation in hypercalcemia, polyuria, dehydration, renal failure. Cardiac is very important. It shortens the QT, widening of T waves, prolonged PR and arrhythmias. I think when we're using medications like methadone for our opioids, I think we should be careful about these cardiac issues specific to all of these electrolytes. And bone, it leads to pain. The moans, groans, and psychological groans are all related to that acronym, which most of us are put across. Now, how do we diagnose this? Is made not only just on the level of the calcium, which is present in the blood. Now, it depends upon the albumin, as I had mentioned. So the measured calcium, which is already there in the blood, the normal albumin usually is taken as 4. And the measured albumin, that is patient who has got hypoalbuminemia, is taken up and then multiplied by a factor called as 0.8. Then you will have the measured calcium or the corrected calcium for the albumin levels which we have. Now, coming back, in advanced cancer patients, even when there is life expectancy, which is very limited, as my case was actually mentioned, plays a very vital role in symptom control. Because even in end of life care, we are more bothered about symptom control, and symptom control, correcting calcium has got a prime importance. Now, the diagnosis is, as I mentioned, you should have a high degree of suspicion when you see a group of symptoms, which we have actually bundled there. You do a laboratory investigation, confirm there is hypercalcemia, have a calcium correction, identify the underlying etiology, could be the parathyroid hormone, not hormone, depending upon the various laboratory investigations. Will I be doing all of these in my practice? I think phosphorus, magnesium, and the parathyroid hormone, if it is required only. If it's a straightforward case, I would be doing all of this. But if you're actually confused, there are a lot of concerns and issues, then we're going to do all the host of things when it becomes resistant for correction. Now, when you do those tests, you know that when calcium goes up in humoral hypercalcemia, phosphorus comes down because these are antagonizing. Even in tumor lysis syndrome, this is exactly what happens. Hypocalcemia will be there, hyperphosphatemia will be there. So parathyroid hormone is less. Only where the parathyroid, the related protein, that is the one which is actually very, very important over here. And I have not got it measured, and I don't have see the facility for me to actually measure that levels exactly in, as of now, in daily to daily practice is what I'm talking about. Well, how do we manage it? Hydration wise, normal saline 3 to 4 liters in 24 hours. Kindly see if the patient has got chronic kidney disease or congestive cardiac failure. It's very, very important when you want to hydrate them. At that point of time, if they've got chronic kidney disease and cardiac issues, I think depending upon the goals of care, goals of management, what are they going to be? Dialysis could be there. Or diuretic has got some way of actually getting the calcium diuresis, but you have to check that you have hydrated the patient well. Now, you could do it with a CVP line if it is possible and if it is indicated only. I'm not telling everybody should be there. So if hypoalbuminemia is there, which is severe, and you rush in fluid for that patient, could lead to a lot of problems and concerns. So therefore, when you're correcting fluids over here with normal saline, and please don't use ringer lactate because, again, it has got calcium over there. So therefore, normal saline is the fluid of choice. Serum calcitonin, that is, I use about 200 international units. You could use it eighth hourly, only in severe hypercalcemia. That is, if it is more than 14 milligrams. percent. Now, bisphosphonates is something which is very, very important. And zoledronic acid, 4 mg IV over 15 minutes. My patient whom I just presented had the creatinine which had gone up. This happens mainly because of calcium going and diuresis which is happening and dehydration. So most of them will all be pre-renal. So you, the moment you hydrate them, things are becoming better. First 24 to 48 hours later, you're actually better off with this. Now, if it is a myeloma patient who's presenting for the first time and severe issues and the creatinine is very, very high, you know that it's going to take a lot of time. You could possibly use the RANK ligators over there. Denosumab could be used, but you will have to be very, very careful. And it has to be a team effort of multidisciplinary team having the hemato-oncologist over there. And they would actually decide on what has to be done. Now, steroids, depending upon the case presentation, my case required 16 mg because it had cord compression ongoing there. So the steroid, which is of dexamethasone only, some of them put across prednisolone and methylprednisolone, but I would actually go simple, cost-effective, and things dexamethasone would be the best. The monitoring of input-output chart is very, very important. Electrolytes and venous pressure is important over here, as I had mentioned, for various reasons. Cinacalcet is one of the agent which actually has called a calcimimetic agent, activates the calcium sensing receptor. This is actually very important in severe primary hyperthyroidism in men 1 and men 2 kind of thing, wherein it is becomes very, very difficult. Even if you've given denosumab, you've given everything. It's usually given as a 60 mg per day. Now, when do we monitor calcium? Only after 2 days of specific to the normalization actually takes about 3 to 5 days, and 80% will completely be better off with all the forms of management in a week's time. Repeating the calcium every hour might not actually have any benefit at all. So you have a suspected case, you have a symptomatic patient with hypermanages as an emergency, reduction of tumor burden should not be forgotten, palliative, non-pharmacological and pharmacological. Pharmacological is something which we've discussed. Non-pharmacological is removal of exogenous calcium sources, discontinue medications that may lead to hypercalcemia, ambulation, weight bearing, that becomes very, very important because it actually brings about osteoblastic activity. So this is something which we can start off in bed activity itself. Asymptomatic patients, just follow up, fluid assess and malignancy follow up has to be done. Coming to the next one, hypocalcemia of malignancy is a life-threatening event. And it is an important when there is an acute onset. Most of them are insidious cases, and they are, most of them are asymptomatic. If it is acute, it is much, much more dangerous compared to hypercalcemia. Hypocalcemia, if you look at the percentage of patients, is around 20 to 30% is the incidence, whereas hypercalcemia, as I had mentioned, was around 10 to 30%. Now, why hypocalcemia is more number, but not evaluated much or taken into account is most of the patients actually go in for iatrogenic hypocalcemia and they are asymptomatic. Now, the cutoff for hypocalcemia is around 8.5 milligrams per deciliter. But what becomes very, very important is if it's severe hypocalcemia, less than 7.5, and there are patients who actually become very symptomatic, then we need to actually correct that as early as possible in an emergent situation, depending upon, as I mentioned, calcium correction for symptom control is very, very important. So we should go ahead and correct them. Now, causes of hypocalcemia based on clinical cues. Now, it could be because of malabsorption syndrome, surgeries. Now, when the parathyroid glands are removed, that could be there. Or renal disease, when we have secondary hyperparathyroidism, as I had mentioned before, PTH-dependent, independent, going down or up is very, very important. You could have acute illnesses like pancreatitis, tumor lysis. These are very, very important when you tumor lysis specifically in hematological cancers. And I will come upon a single slide on tumor lysis. Secondary hyperparathyroidism is what we have seen from the low circulating levels of calcium. This we could definitely be looking into. Now, there are autoimmune diseases of the parathyroid gland destruction. If these are there, that also could be there. So actually history taking and understanding what it could be becomes more important in hypocalcemia, as we have seen in hypercalcemia also. In malignancy specific, Now, if there are the why there is a reason for hypocalcemia is aggressive osteoblastic metastasis, treatment-induced complications of hypercalcemia. The patient will present to you hypercalcemia, but once you actually start giving bisphosphonates or the rank ligator denosumab, the patients actually go into hypocalcemia. Specific to denosumab, wherein you see severe hypocalcemias presented with some of the patients wherein they would be treated with the denosumab within a week or 10 days or so. Adverse effects of chemotherapy like cisplatin 5-FU and leucovorin, GI tumors when they actually on FOLFOX regimen could also lead to this. They actually also be looked for impairment in magnesium homeostasis because in the intestines, the absorption of calcium and magnesium are dependent. I will come to that in the magnesium ion over there, wherein the correlation is much, much more evident. Lactic acidosis could be because of sepsis or shock. Secondary hypoparathyroidism, that is progressive cancer disease with bone metastasis, could lead to this. Symptomatic hypocalcemia, transfusion of citrated blood or plasma, especially in those with hepatic and renal failure, that is when you're actually having a vital organ damage, wherein a homeostasis of the calcium is not possible by then, and you give high transfusions for a patient in a short period of time, usually then you have. Now, the clinical features, muscular is this fatigue, weakness, severe cramps, and spasms could be there. Tetany is the neurological sign over here. The Troche sign or the Chivas sign is something which we will see. Hallucinations, dementia, seizures, extrapyramidal disorders. Now, the other one, most important, cardiovascular, heart failure, ventricular arrhythmias, specific to torsade points. This is something which could be seen in magnesium also. I will talk about that in magnesium also. Vasoconstriction, skeletal osteodystrophy, rickets, osteomalacia could be there. Now, Troche signs is very, very important. Induction of carpopedal spasm by inflation of the sphygmomanometers. That is when you actually measure the systolic blood pressure for more than 3 minutes. That is you increase it by 20 millimeters of mercury more than the normal, whatever the measured systolic blood pressure is. The carpopedal spasm is actually elicited over there, that it leads to adduction of the thumb, flexion of the metacarpophalangeal joints, extension of the interphalangeal joints and flexion of the wrist. Or when you actually have facial muscle spasms, that is you are irritating the nerve by tapping it on the facial nerve. This leads to twitching in the lip, spasm and facial muscles. Now, diagnosis. How do we obtain a diagnosis? Obtain ionized calcium level, draw for magnesium and phosphate and parathyroid hormone. Hypocalcemia, if there is magnesium issue, you just give magnesium. If renal function is normal, magnesium is low, you give the magnesium, then it gets corrected. Diagnosis of hypomagnesemia is made. If not, hypomagnesemia is not and it is already corrected, then elevated serum phosphate has to be looked. If it is high, high parathyroid hormone will be the causes, pseudo-hyperparathyroidism. I'll come in phosphate related issues and concerns over there. Low parathyroid hormone, hypoparathyroidism of various etiologies could be checked, as I mentioned, in the calcium itself. Calcium and phosphate are dependent on severely on the PTH, that's the parathyroid hormone. If it is low, vitamin D deficiency is something which we'll have to look for and measure the 25-hydroxycholecalciferol, that is the active form of vitamin D. Now, explaining this entire slide is too much. I think the slides will be shared. Please have a look at it. And it takes some time for all of us to actually assimilate that. And what I do is put this as a ready reckoner in my mobile. I think once we have a ready reckoner and we go through this, it is easier for us to actually look into it rather than having to mug it up completely. It becomes difficult for me also. What is the management plan? Depends upon the severity, clinical manifestation and underlying etiology. Wherever it's correctable for the underlying etiology, please go and correct that underlying etiology as much as possible, if it is possible, depending upon the goals of care, as well as I'm mentioning from the slide one. Severe hypocalcemia, I did mention about 7.5 milligrams per deciliter. Our main goal is to reduce symptoms, reverse skeletal demineralization, which is happening, maintain acceptable total calcium concentration, avoid hypercalciuria. That is a 24-hour urine calcium of loss of more than 300 milligrams should be avoided. As I mentioned, magnesium and calcium are very much related. And the flow chart also mentioned about the magnesium being normal or abnormal. First is check for normal magnesium. If magnesium is normal, 10% calcium gluconate, that is 10 ml ampules diluted in 50 to 100 ml of 5% dextrose solution is given over 10 minutes. Now, continuous infusions could be there. That is about 10 ampules of the 10% calcium gluconate diluted in 1 liter of 5% dextrose solution. You could run at around 50 ml per hour. I think the total calcium concentration monitoring could be every hour if the severity is very high and patient has got severe hypocalcemia symptoms over here. And until it is corrected, you'll have to check specific to cardiac issues, TOS-AD points or something which is actually going on over there. You will have to actually get that corrected properly. Infusion rate estimated to arise about 0.3 to 1 milligram elemental calcium per kg per hour. Once normal calcemia is reached and patient is stabilized, oral supplementation with calcium carbonate or calcium citrate can be prescribed. Vitamin 3 and calcitrol should be included in your oral supplementation because it enhances the calcium acceptance in the or absorption in the intestine. When you have low magnesium, it is difficult to correct without normalizing magnesium. That is, first you'll have to correct the magnesium to correct hypocalcemia. So magnesium sulfate 2 grams in 20 ml of dextrose in water, be infused during 10 to 20 minutes. Infusion of 1 gram in 100 ml of dextrose in water. Magnesium serum levels remain less than 1 milligram per deciliter. Calcitrol should be administered if hypoparathyroidism or renal failure is present. Hypercalciuria during calcium or vitamin D supplementation, if they are actually there, chlorothiazide or chlorothalidone may be beneficial. Now, we have a suspected case. Patient is symptomatic. Asymptomatic, just follow up. Symptomatic, patients with severe hypocalcemia. Severe is 7.5 milligrams per deciliter, less than that. Manage as an emergent situation, okay? Non-pharmacological measures, calcium concentration monitoring every hour. That is when you have cardiac instability going on. I think all of these calcium gluconate, oral calcium supplementation, and magnesium supplementation, if it is of an issue, has been mentioned. Coming to the next electrolyte, magnesium. Now, if it is under-recognized, will lead to serious consequences. Now, this is where you have a lot of problems, which is correlating with your hypocalcemia. Magnesium is the fourth most abundant cation, whereas calcium is the first, second most abundant intracellular cation. Now, where do we see magnesium being low? In hospitalized patients, around 7 to 11% is where we see end-stage cancer disease. It can go up to almost 44%. That is almost you will have every third patient having hypomagnesemia. Now, total body magnesium concentration is about 25 grams. Most of the investigations, especially renal function tests, also do not have magnesium included in most of them. So we will have to ask for the magnesium levels separately. Now, how does the homeostasis occur for magnesium? Now, dietary intake is around 360 milligrams, whereas calcium is around 1000 milligrams is required in a normal adult, in pediatric or the elderly, it's around 1200 milligrams. For pediatric, depending upon body weight, it is actually checked for. Now, the major account is for the intestinal absorption. 20 to 60% is actually intaken, and there is a percentage which is not absorbed, goes into excretion, fecal excretion. Now, plasma is around 1.5 to 1.9 milliequivalents per liter. 70% is ionized, 20% is protein bound. Now, in terms of actually the excretion, which actually occurs through the kidney, urinary excretion is about 5% only. Now, intracellular component, where compartment, where it is in the muscle and other tissues, that is 10 to 15% of total magnesium is there in the muscle and other tissues. Now, bone, which is actually forms the 60 to 65%. As I had mentioned, as same as calcium, a mineralized component and a cation component, it's the same applicable for all calcium, magnesium, and phosphate. Now, intestinal absorption, I've actually put this actually a little bit more, whereas the calcium homeostasis is parathyroid dependent. Now, the intestinal absorption of magnesium occurs in the large intestine and small intestine. Small intestine is just passive diffusion and it is dependent on the claudin-16 tight group intercellular receptors are there. Magnesium is absorbed through that. Now, what is more important is the large intestine, whereas there is active transportation occurring over here. Active transportation across requires the TRPM6 transient receptor potential, myelostatin 6 and 7. That is what is most important over here. Once these get affected, specific to oncological issues, these chemotherapy treatment, which leads to a lot of problems in these receptors, that's the TRPM6 and 7, will lead not only to magnesium, you can see sodium and potassium, wherein the exchange is happening over there, can lead to a lot of these issues and concerns of hyper-hypo, depending upon the stage correction and how we are actually taking it ahead. So even calcium gets affected in magnesium, as I had mentioned before. Now, renal homeostasis, very important for all the three electrolytes. I've actually split that. I've not put across everything into calcium because I had calcium, hypocalcemia, and hypercalcemia over here. Renal homeostasis, you can see that 5% should be the one which is actually getting excreted. Now, ultrafiltrate, once it goes through, at the proximal tubule, 15 to 25% gets absorbed, that is brought in. Now, whereas in the ascending or the ascending loop of Henle, around 65% to 75% is actually absorbed. That's the major component. If you look at the calcium, the proximal tubule is actually wherein the absorption actually starts occurring, whereas the phosphate reabsorption occurs in the distal convoluted tubule. So therefore, all these electrolytes are interconnected. Could maybe the parathyroid hormone, which is the most commonest and the most effective of all for the calcium and the phosphate, interrelated to the GI issues and the renal issues, wherein you have your magnesium going in and the reverse towards the effect on the vitamin D levels also. So all of these are all interlinked. So therefore, we will have to have a high degree of suspicion whenever we find the symptoms which we mentioned. What is the role of magnesium in our body? It is mainly the energy transfer, production and storage is where your mitochondria, your ATP, all those things are very, very important over here. Metabolism of protein and carbohydrate, maintenance of normal cell function, regulation of parathyroid hormone secretion. See, again, parathyroid hormone is dependent on the magnesium over here. So therefore, it is again important. Peripheral vascular resistance. This is very, very important for our kidney disease patients as well as our cardiac disease patients. And pain modulation. Now, this is where we actually have a lot of issues and concerns when it comes to pain modulation. Now, most of the times, whenever there is severe neuropathic pain, I have actually used a lot of magnesium corrections even in the ER. And I had presented one of the posters in the recent conference which occurred on IAPCon 2020. And it brings about a lot of change in terms of actually relaxing the membrane stability and other things which happen because of pain specific to antagonizing calcium, which actually increases the pain perception. Now, hypomagnesemia is what I'm going to talk about. What is it? If the concentration is below 0.66 millimoles or 1.6 milligrams per deciliter, usually 1.6 milligrams deciliter is not symptomatic. And if it goes below that, around 1.4 or so, it starts becoming to show up. Now, what are the etiologies of hypomagnesemia? It could be extra renal, because that's why I mentioned the kidneys to a large extent and the GI in the picture of magnesium acceptance or magnesium absorption, what is happening. So therefore, you could have extra renal losses, that is in the GI. When you have all of this malignancy of GI tract is what we're actually talking about. And do not forget the FOLFOX regimen, which I'd mentioned before. Decreased gastrointestinal absorption is something which could be there. Now, specific to that, we all give a lot of proton pump inhibitors. So that is somewhere which we'll have to look into a large extent. Now, malnutrition and alcoholism, that's something which we will have to have a high degree of suspicion when patients actually come with a lot of cancer, which is related to alcoholism or smoking and other forms of abuse. Now, refeeding syndrome, this can occur in patients who are actually prolonged oral intake is not there, could be about weeks to 10 days, and then you start feeding them. That's called as refeeding syndrome, could be there to have hypomagnesemia to be seen in these patients. Now, reduced renal loss, sodium reabsorption, or saline infusions could be the cause. Disease which is related to the renal obstructive nephropathy, dialysis patients are very, very important. So these are some of the related to renal causes. Now, miscellaneous are a lot of it, specific to acidosis. When you have sepsis, I think this is where the problem it gets to, increased in ionized magnesium fraction. Now, when you're actually coming to what is relevant to us, when we are actually looking in for patients who are in palliation, now reduced oral or intravenous intake when they're on TPN, magnesium deficit diet, intestinal resections to happen for a lot of patients, fistula, that's very, very important. Short bowel syndromes could be there. When you're using a lot of loop diuretics, proton pump inhibitors, as I mentioned before, now it could be some with antivirals and antibiotics also. Non-renal losses could be vomiting, excessive sweating, diabetes insipidus, hyperparathyroidism, and hyperthyroidism also could be there. Now, outcomes of of the hypomagnesemia. I'm not covering this hypermagnesemia. Hypomagnesemia is where we are actually talking about. When we have less than 1.1, then you have neuromuscular instability, tremors, hypocalcemia, hypokalemia also will be there. So I think Kritika has done a wonderful job last week of introducing what is the importance of electrolytes and how we go about doing it. And hypokalemia is something which she has covered extensively last class. So over here, when you have hypomagnesemia, you can have hypocalcemia. That is where I had actually mentioned in hypocalcemia, you have to correct hypomagnesemia also. Now, the tetany, nystagmus, seizure, psychosis, and arrhythmia, if you see the symptoms, it's almost the same. And cardiovascular is where the incident of chronic kidney disease, atrial fibrillation, heart failures could actually be a problem. Now, there is a severity of grading for hypomagnesemia. National Cancer Institute has actually put across. Now, if you have grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, grade 4, grade 4 is severe form wherein it is less than 0.7 milligrams. Now, coming to the symptom, what is going to be seen in that? If you see my previous slide, hypocalcemia showed the same thing of Schwann sign and Trochier sign over here, tremors, fasciculations. Cardiovascular, atherosclerotic vascular disease, and coronary artery disease, Torsady points is the most important. I will come to the correction of how do we go about treating Torsady points. Congestive heart failure could be there. Now, biochemical and other issues could be hypokalemia, hypocalcemia is what we will have to look into. Now, reason why each clinical manifestation will occur with magnesium being low. I have extensively written this. The slide will be circulated. I think due to lack of time, reading through each and every specific thing becomes difficult. So the most commonest of the problems, which is the cardiac arrhythmias. I think modulation, regulation of calcium channels and sodium potassium membrane pump gets affected. As I mentioned, one electrolyte change will lead to intestinal, renal, parathyroid hormone going into circle. So therefore leads to a issue. What happens is you have so many dyselectrolemias, it actually shortens the action potential because all of them have got issues on the conduction and increase susceptibility to cardiac arrhythmias, which leads to a lot of problems in the rhythm of a patient's cardiac. Laboratory measurements of hypomagnesemia, I think total serum magnesium is actually measured. As we correct calcium, magnesium also needs to be corrected. But here the correction factor is about 0.005, whereas for calcium is 0.8. Now, if you have some patients which who are asymptomatic, but magnesium levels are low, there's a magnesium loading test and collecting urine for 24 hours and checking their levels. And you challenge them after you've checked the 24 hours of urine magnesium levels and challenge them with 2.4 milligrams per kg of lean body weight with magnesium over 4 hours. And then second urine collection for 24 hours is done. Now, if there is deficit, the excretion is less than 80%. Whereas there are changes which we could see, or some measurements which we could see, if whether it is renal or gastrointestinal magnesium wasting. I think it becomes too much of investigations, and I think I've written it, I've put it across, and I've given the where I've taken it up. I think you can actually have a read. There are other tests which are available to complete for the sake of actually the class. I've actually mentioned it over there. You could look into these if you are actually academically oriented and if you want to read about it. Now, when it comes to correction, if you have an asymptomatic hypomagnesemia patient, now you actually need to just supplement oral. It could be magnesium lactate, chloride, and gluconate. Three types of there. The magnesium chloride and lactate have got 10 or 12%, and that is where actually it is important for dietary intake. I'll just show the slide. Whereas magnesium lactate and chloride, the bioavailability is for magnesium lactate is excellent, and magnesium chloride is good. So the biggest problem is tolerability, and for the diarrhea, you can look, the diarrheal levels are less, whereas the other forms, the diarrhea is very, very high. So therefore, these are the three, the salts which are actually proposed for acceptance, or if orally, if it needs to be supplemented for patients who are asymptomatic. Now, moderate to severe hypocalcemia, the goal should be to achieve serum magnesium concentrations of 0.8 milliequivalents per liter as quickly as possible to bring it to 1.2. Now, 1 gram of magnesium sulfate contains 100 milligrams, 4 moles or 8 milliequivalents of elemental calcium, 98 milligrams of elemental magnesium. IV magnesium sulfate preparation comes in 10, 20 and 50% solution. Please look into whatever percentage you are using. In patient with chronic kidney disease, this is where it becomes important that those should be reduced by 25 to 50%. I think having the nephrology team, most of them will look into it, specific to when dialysis and other things are going on, they will be there. We could actually ask, and we should be doing that. Estimation of 0.1 milliequivalents per liter increases in serum magnesium concentration for every 1 gram of intravenous magnesium sulfate, which has been supplemented. Now, moderate to severe hypomagnesemia, I think life-threatening is what we would be more interested. 4 to 8 grams of magnesium infused over 24 hours. Infusion as per magnesium monitoring, treat other dyselectrolemias which come with the magnesium, which I have told about hypocalcemia also. Now, this is what is most important. Management of toxicity points. Patient is conscious or hemodynamically stable. IV magnesium sulfate 2 grams is given slowly over 15 minutes. Magnesium is given irrespective of the serum magnesium levels. When you know saying that toxicity points are happening, there is no loss. It's something which when you actually can give magnesium. Giving it in the ER is something which I do regularly of 2 grams. And it is something which is safe. Repeated every 5 to 15 minutes, depending upon the toxicity points, if they persist, when you're correcting the others also, that is calcium also, if there is hypocalcemia present. Monitor for signs and symptoms of hypermagnesemia, bradycardia, hypotension, muscle weakness, hypoactive, that's the reverse. That is, you have hypoactive deep tendon reflexes could be there. Now, antidote, if hypermagnesemia is actually there, intravenous calcium could be something which could be given 100 to 200 milligrams over 5 to 10 minutes. Now, when you have chemotherapy patients and if you have related hypomagnesemia specific to epidermal growth related factor inhibitors, that is cetuximab, cisplatin, specific to cisplatin and cyclosporin, wherein you have issues with the renal toxicity, as I had mentioned, where it could actually lead to the maximum amount. That is, you should have just 5% of magnesium being lost. But if you have more than that, then you know there is a renal damage which is already there. It could be reflecting on your serum creatinine levels also. Management as per correction protocols with renal impairment, as I had mentioned before, 25 to 50% is what the reduction is. Weekly IV replacement is typically inadequate in these groups. Usually when you have cisplatin or the other treatment regimens which I've mentioned over here, they do supplement, but they come once a week for chemotherapy. At that point of time, they are supplemented, but might not be enough. Serum magnesium levels falls to low baseline levels within 3 to 4 days itself after it has been supplemented. So you will have to check and look into it. Regular monitoring of magnesium until a steady state is reached is what is important, specific to chemotherapy patients who are actually on these regimens. Serum magnesium level corrects within 6 weeks of stopping. cetuximab. So therefore, it is important that it takes a long period of time for the hypomagnesemia to be corrected. Polypharmacy should be reviewed, which could be of there. Now, when you have chronic kidney disease, glomerular filtration rate is what is most important importance for magnesium. If your creatinine clearance is less than 30 ml per minute, the tubulointestinal reabsorption of magnesium is impaired. We know that a lot of it goes into the ascending limb, wherein it actually gets absorbed. 60 to 70% gets absorbed over there. Calcium sensing receptor is what is important. And this is where calcium and magnesium becomes interlinked, as I'd mentioned in the diagram I'd shown before. Low dietary magnesium intake should be checked for and actually corrected. Now, what happens in kidney disease, it actually, the conversion of vitamin D active form is actually affected. Now, once that is affected, intestinal magnesium absorption also gets affected. So therefore, kidney is also affected. The indirectly, it affects the intestine wherein absorption takes place. Now, when you have a patient on dialysis, magnesium concentration influences the magnesium balance and levels within that. Now, co-medications and interactions may induce hypomagnesemia when patient is on dialysis. So that also has to be looked into. So when it's coming to magnesium, hypomagnesemia, you should have a high degree of suspicion. Concurrent electrolyte abnormalities, hypokalemia, hypocalcemia have to be looked into. 25 to 50% is the initial dose recommended of patients with low creatinine clearance, that is in kidney disease. Significant urinary excretion of magnesium with rapid correction can be there. Review polypharmacy, multidisciplinary approach. This is the most safest is what I feel. It gets excreted in the urine for most of it. Now, coming to the last part of my talk, I've got about another 11 minutes. Phosphate ion is what it is going to be. It's a major intracellular anion. We are all talking about cation. Now we're talking about anion. This is the last one. Now, if you look at the distribution of phosphate, again, you can look, most of it is in the bone and other tissues and extracellular fluid. Extracellular fluid, again, look into this. Protein bound is just 10%, whereas in calcium and magnesium, I've mentioned the protein bound is more, 50%, 40%, and things like that. Whereas complex with sodium, calcium, and magnesium as salts, these are all mineral that is in the bone and teeth. Whereas as salts is around 5%. Inorganic phosphate ion is in level of around 85%. Now, homeostasis of phosphate. Plasma phosphorus is filtered, enters tubular fluid in approximately the same concentration as those present in the plasma. That is, now, when you take about 20 milligrams per day from the intestine, what is absorbed is around 16 milligrams. Now, once it is actually having a 16 milligrams per day of absorption, that is what actually enters the phosphorus pool. And in the kidney, actually around 13 milligrams per deciliter is excreted out. Now, this is what the 13 milligrams is what is actually circulating everywhere over here also. Now, why this happens is amongst the 16 milligrams, 3 milligrams again goes into the digestive juices and it is secreted out as digestive juices, as a component of the digestive juice. Hormones that control the homeostasis of the phosphate, as I had mentioned before, parathyroid hormone related. It could be vitamin D, fibroblasts. It's almost the same as calcium. There is not much of a difference at all. Now, sodium phosphate co-transporters are reliable for majority of physiological phosphate transport. Now, coming back to the same diagram, which I had actually shown you some time ago about the calcium, the homeostasis. Now, here, first is parathyroid hormone. You look at it, parathyroid hormone gets secreted from the parathyroid glands. It has got three components. That is, osteoclastic activity increases calcium and phosphate release. Okay, normal levels are there. Now, it also tells the 5-1 alpha hydroxylase to work in the kidneys, which actually helps in the conversion to 25 hydroxy cholecalciferol to dihydroxycholecalciferol. This is most important, increases in abdominal binding. Same in magnesium to a large extent, which we have actually discussed about. So over here, calcium and phosphate absorption increases, so therefore normalized. When you have an increased level of the phosphate, it has got a negative factor which actually affects, that is the FGF23. That is the most fibroblast growth factor 23 is the most important of all to inhibit that. Now, what it does is you can see the red lines over here, the inhibition, the FGF23, once there is increase in the 125 hydroxycholic calciferol as well as phosphate, it tells them to actually shut down. That is 1-alpha hydroxylase, wherein it is PTH increases it, the FGF23 decreases it. So therefore the conversion comes down, absorption comes down. So there is net wasting of phosphate because it tells the urinary excretion also to increase. So therefore this is the check thing. So one, the FGF23 decreases the 1-alpha hydroxylase, increase the degradation of 25-dihydroxy vitamin D, that's active vitamin D. Urinary phosphorus excretion is actually increased. Parathyroid hormone stimulation is actually decreased. This is very, very important as I was talking. So therefore, when you have decreased parathyroid hormone, calcium also gets affected, magnesium also gets affected. Now, what are the causes? Excessive phosphate load is seen in massive tissue breakdown, rhabdomyolysis, tumor lysis syndrome. This is where we are important and which has to be looked into, or hemolysis. Excessive phosphate intake could be there. Hypervitaminosis D is also there. Now in renal, chronic kidney disease, tumor calcinosis, FGF resistance is there, so leading to hyperphosphatemia. So this is something which we see. Transcellular shift actually occurs in lactic acidosis, diabetic ketoacidosis, phosphate shift out of the cell. Pseudo hypoparathyroidism. This is very important when you have resistance to the parathyroid hormone and its receptor actually is resistant to the parathyroid hormone. Here in this case, you'll have low serum calcium, high serum phosphate, and inappropriately high parathyroid. That is secondary hyperparathyroidism is seen over here. Now, what are the clinical features which you see? Very much you will see in CNS delirium, seizures, neuromuscular hyperexcitability, muscle cramping, tetany. This is the same thing which we are seeing in hypocalcemia also. Schwartz sign, Trochu sign is something which we have already explained. Hypertension, heart failure, vascular calcification. This is what is very important, hyperphosphatemia. This is what could lead to a lot of patients with chronic kidney disease ending up in cardiac issues. Atherosclerosis, wide pulse pressure, left ventricular hypertrophy could be seen. Now bone and skin, precipitation in skin, soft tissue and periarticular region could be there. Demineralization can lead to bone fractures. So these are certain things which are seen on a chronic event, not on a acute event. I think CVS is what we will have to see. And most commonest of all, which we see is the tumor lysis syndrome. That is what is important for us. Most of the times we will see tumor lysis in hemato-oncology patients who have actually just gone in for induction therapy. What are the electrolytes which are seen over there? Hyperkalemia will be there. The only electrolyte which is less is hypocalcemia. You will have hyperphosphatemia also over here. So therefore, I think it is beyond my capacity to talk about entire tumor lysis over here. It would take at least about another 5 to 10 minutes. I've got about 5 more minutes over here to finish my class. Now, when it comes to monitoring calcium levels for children, for adults in chronic kidney disease, it is very, very important. That is, mild to moderately decreased itself for creatinine clearance. That is, creatinine clearance of 45 to 59 is what is looked for in adults. Whereas in children, mildly decreased, that is 60 to 89 is something which has to be looked in for surveillance. That is, hyperphosphatemia with end-stage renal disease, prevalence varies from 50 to 74%. So therefore, it has to be looked in for when you have chronic kidney disease. And it is different for pediatric, different for adult. Pediatric, you'll have to check earlier. For adult, it's a little bit later. Now, hypophosphatemia and chronic kidney disease, 18% increase in mortality per 1 milligram deciliter. Increase in serum phosphorus of more than 3.5 milligrams deciliter could lead to all these issues. Failure to produce the 125-dihydroxy vitamin D modifies the risk of developing cardiac and renal issues. Worsens kidney insufficiency. Hyperphosphatemia induced high phosphorus concentration leads to osteochondrogenic differentiation, smooth muscles cells into bone cells. So this is what is important when you have chronic kidney disease and hyperphosphatemia. In this, it leads to metabolic bone disease. So when you're actually having metabolic bone disease, the three Ds are actually checked in for diet, dialysis, and drugs. I think these are certain things which are the key element when you have chronic kidney disease, as I mentioned, leads to metabolic bone disease is something which we'll have to have an approach on all these three. It is a it is not only dialysis and drugs. Diet is something which the renal people, that's a nephrologist, will be very, very particular about, and they would say what should be avoided and what should not be taken. Now, in chronic kidney disease, improving the global outcomes, the update is assessment of phosphate, calcium, and parathyroid hormones level should be considered together, and it should not be separate. There are multiple phosphate binding agents. I think this is something which is there. Most of the nephrology group, wherever they are, they will be using it. I think this is what is important. Now, multidisciplinary care is what is important. I think the patients, if they are unaware of guidelines, lack of belief of pre-dialysis restrictions, prescription of the phosphate binders, lack of evidence. So therefore, I think that is something which the nephrology will look into. P binders actually have a lot of adherence, number of pills, intolerance, galenic forms, individual preferences, and lack of knowledge is something which looked for. Now, prevention of hyperphosphatemia should be tried with all these as much as possible. But if it develops, you will have increased hyperparathyroidism, increased cardiovascular and global mortality. So therefore, that has to be looked into. And if there is FGF, fibroblast growth factor 23, if it is increased, then it leads to a lot of aging changes is what is actually mentioned. Now, mortality secondary to hyperphosphatemia, you should have an assist shared decision-making, improved patient quality of life and longevity goals of care. Now, understanding the consequences of hyperphosphatemia has to be told for the patient when specific to kidney disease is there. You have hemodynamic disturbances over here leading to stroke, heart rate could be affected, both diastolic and systolic blood pressure. So wide pulse pressure is there. So therefore, the chances of cardiovascular morbidity leading to stroke could be there. Cardiovascular calcification becomes higher. So coronary artery calcification leading to ischemia and myocardial infarction, as well as valve calcification could be there. Arrhythmias and sudden death also is possible. Now, take home points, major control point for phosphate homeostasis is the kidney. Whereas in magnesium also, it is to a large extent intestine and the kidneys. 18% increase in mortality per milligram deciliter increase in serum phosphate, that is to more than 3.5 milligrams per deciliter. Diet, dialysis, and drugs is the cornerstone for management in kidney disease with the metabolic bone disease also. Non-pharmacological means are very important for all of it. All the three I've mentioned, non-pharmacological measures have to be looked. For calcium, it's just movements. Now, diet and other aspects could be looked into for both magnesium as well as for hyperphosphatemia. Increased cardiovascular morbidity specific to this hyperphosphatemia is something which is there. Please look into goals of care for all the patients, and improving quality of life and dignity of life is what we actually have always thought about. And that is what we should actually look into. And communication, 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 as all my teachers have told, that's the most important. It is just not treating one electrolyte or anything, understanding them, giving them the preferences, what it is, and take back what is needed for them in the best way possible from our end. Thank you.
So, Arun, it's already 7:30, but if there are very important questions, we can discuss all those. Thank you, Raghavinder, for excellent presentation. And Kritika and you both together have summarized electrolyte management so well. And before Arun starts speaking the question answer, I have just one important comment to say. All palliative care physicians, they have to understand and they should know all about this kind of minimum aspect of medicine. If you really want to integrate palliative medicine in other branches, you have to have a knowledge of all these important, but very, very relevant for our patients. It is not that patient in the end stage, it is imbalance management is required. Even in the early stage, if you will go and see the patients in any other branches or in the ward, and if you don't have knowledge, such kind of a minimum knowledge, I don't think anybody will listen to you. So this is very important that we should have a minimum and relevant knowledge of all these important topics, and especially electrolyte imbalance, in every aspect and in various circumstances. So Arun, now you can go ahead with the question answer.
Yes, first question is from Stan. Stan, I can see you there. Would you like to ask? You can just unmute yourself and ask.
What I was asking is, what's the role of palliative sedation, you know, in patients at home who have possible dyselectrolytemia, you know, because they don't want any more admission or, you know, any other investigations as such. So,
Sir, I think you're an expert in that. I think home care services, yes, once the goals of care is something which we have communicated and the patient says, I don't want to get anything done. Now, even home care sampling is something which is possible if we could actually try to correct after discussion with them. If they say, I don't want it, I think palliative sedation with a patient who's got calcium levels which could be easily corrected, we should try our level best to communicate and try to correct it. If not, I think palliative sedation is something which we could take it up, sir. Even in end stage, last 24 to 48 hours also, the trauma, the mental trauma which the patient's attenders will go through, like your chemical restraints is fine, but if it's going up to a physical restraint, I think that is somewhere which brings about a lot of trauma. And as a part of anesthesia team, about 15 years when I started my learning my anesthesia when I was in ICU, I think physical restraints was the most commonest. And in the last 10 years, after my teachers have put across, you can't restrain a person to the bed physically. I think that's where the chemical restraint actually became much, much more. Even now, most of them who are not sensitized ICU, they actually physically restrain them. And end of life care being restrained to a bed, I feel it's too traumatic for us who are already sensitized about restraints.
Yeah. Certainly, yeah. No physical restraint. Agreed. Sorry, can I ask the other question also, which I had posted? What is the evidence, you know, for this this electrolyte management in end-of-life care in terms of prognosis?
So prognostication might not be extensively changed. You will have some more, your end-of-life care, your most important thing is symptom management, symptom control.
Quality.
Your quality and dignity is what is important. Prognostication is not important in end-of-life care. Specific to the last few hours, if you have a patient who's actually active dying and you have something like delirium, which is one of our cardinal symptoms, and you have an issue over there, I think we need to correct that as much as possible, is what I feel. Now, prognostication for me, he lives 24 hours, 48 hours or a week. I have no much of thought and change about that.
Thank you, sir.
One more question from our MD student, MD training, Kashish. She's asking if hypercalcemia of malignancy can be recurrent. And apart from the immediate management of hypercalcemia in malignancy, is there anything else that can be done?
I think it can be recurrent, depending upon where is the tumor and what's happening over there. The second part, Arun, what was it?
She's asking if anything else can be done apart from treating the hypercalcemia of malignancy, if it is recurrent.
I think finding the source, why it's happening, is most important there.
Yeah, that, and directed management probably will take care of
the... So therefore, you will go deep into what is the changes which are there. You're going to get the management protocol, which I've told how to diagnose, go about actually investigating it. I think that is what is most important. Investigation, find out what are the imbalances or what is the cause for it, and then go accordingly to treat it.
We'll take one more question. That's it, because we're running out of time. So from Dr. Kamla from Chennai. So can you list out dietary restrictions and dietary supplements for hypo and hypercalcemia and magnesemia? I think you have covered it.
I think I've spoken about it. Yeah. Now, in terms of actually calcium, see, milk of magnesium, which we actually give a lot, it could be in terms of proton pump inhibitors and other things which I mentioned. I think it's all the common things which we look into, most of it. These drugs, which actually act on the GI as well as the renals, those are very, very important. Or vitamin D, whatever is related to vitamin D will be related to this. And most of our patients who are in oncology will be on multiple supplementation of vitamin D3, calcium, citrate, all of that will be there. we would have seen that host of these medications will be still going on later on after they have stopped their chemotherapy, because they think saying that multivitamins are most important. I think those are some of the food fads which we see in patients. And most of the times we will actually, in palliation, we will stop supplementing them with so many of the multivitamins. I think they'll be on 3 or 4 multivitamins specific to if they're on a kidney patient and they have actually have chronic kidney disease, nephrologist is being seen and is seen by a general physician. General physician also would have added something and the renal person also would have added some other thing. So therefore, looking into those are important is what I feel.
Thank you. This is the last question and then we'll turn over to Sushma Madam. Last question is there anything called as refractory hypercalcemia, which is also a bad prognostic indicator?
Yeah, there is. Now, I had mentioned in my slide itself that there is, if there is primary para-hyperthyroidism, which is there in the management, the Cinacalcet, that is the calcium sensing receptor, which is actually seen as severe primary hyperparathyroidism, wherein you've done everything, hydration, you've given your bisphosphonates, you've given your diuresis, everything has done, but it'll come down marginally and then again rise. This is seen in severe primary hyperparathyroidism. So it is a calcium sensing receptor, which actually is given 60 mg per day. Cinacalcet, that is actually as an emerging now. FDA has just approved it for this purpose. I think that is something which we can see after even denosumab. It has been seen saying that to recur hypercalcemia can be seen in these group of patients.
Yes, thank you very much. I'll turn over to Sushma Madam, please. Sushma Madam.
Raghavinder. Thank you, Raghavinder, and thank you, ma'am. Everyone, for joining us. I think how many participants already? 68 participants are. They must have left because we are overshooting time, and we are very concerned about timing. So we will finish it, and we are going to start a very exciting chapter from next Monday onwards. That is pediatric palliative care. Dr. Marianne, Dr. Gayatri, and Dr. Lulu, plus Rakesh. I think all these people will explain you. How should we handle a child when we come across in our palliative care setting? So please be there next Monday before 6:30 and have a nice good and wonderful week. Thank you very much. Thank you, Arun. Thank you, Raghavinder and Nisha. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Nisha, for that wonderful coordination and Arun for hosting it. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.